faith is a journey. It's an unwavering trust that God will show you the way through life's toughest moments. Faith is confidence in what we hope for, and it's an assurance about things we can't see. Faith is a walk that God promises will lead to a life of fullness and purpose.
I will stand in faith. Let the church rise up.
Faith is a journey that you'll never take alone. So let's start walking by it.
Well, good morning, River of Life. It is great to be with you. I am pumped because this is the finale of our series, Walking by Faith. We have seen that we do not have faith in faith. Many times we don't even understand that word, but we have looked and we have studied and we have laughed and cried and we have found out that Jesus Christ is our source. So it's not just faith in faith, it's faith in Him. It's all about relationship. And when we realize that, He strengthens us and He grows us. And so this morning, we are going to look at 1 Timothy chapter 1, 18 through 20, as we kind of put a bow on all of this. Now, I want to encourage you to keep walking in faith. As Paul says, keep in step with the Spirit as we continue to do what God has called us to do. Well, let's look at the text and then we're going to break it down. It says this in verse 18, 1 Timothy chapter 1. This charge I entrust to you, Timothy, in accordance with the prophecies previously made about you, that by them you may wage the good warfare, holding faith and a good conscience. By rejecting this, some have made shipwreck of their faith, among whom are Hymenaeus and Alexander, who I have handed over to Satan that they may not learn to blaspheme. Now, the key phrase in those verses is in verse 18, where Paul says to Timothy, I charge, I entrust to you, in accordance with the prophecies previously made about you, that by them you may wage the good warfare. Now, I believe we realize we are engaged in a spiritual struggle that has spiritual consequences. In fact, Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of the evil in heavenly places. When you go back up to 1 Timothy chapter 1, he's showing us, listen, relationship with Jesus is critical. He is our source. We have to hold on to Him. So he encourages Timothy. We're going to see in a minute, he actually commands Timothy that, hey, hold on to your faith. You do that by keeping a good conscience. He lets us know that some people, some Christians, have literally disregarded their faith. They have become sloppy in their living. Paul says they've shipwrecked it. It's shattered. And by the text, Paul lets us know we have continued to let them know that this is a warfare, this is a battle, but they did not heed to our call. They did not gravitate to our love and what we were teaching through the word of God. So their faith was shipwrecked. And now Paul says they're living in the world. Their mindset is worldly. In fact, it's of the enemy. Therefore, that covering of the spirit is gone because they're no longer, and this is what it's saying, in relationship with Him, with the Lord. So as you and I walk by faith, we have to be aware of this battle. Now, the enemy has a game plan. You can go to Revelation chapter 12 and look through 17 verses there. It kind of gives you an overset of what this game plan is all about. We're not gonna read that all, but I want to show you who the enemy is targeting. He wants to target Christ. I mean, in verses 4 and 5, we see that. He also wants to target the nation of Israel. We see that in verse 6 and in verse 17. He actually goes after the angelic host in verse 7 of Revelation chapter 12. You say, what? Why angels? Well, Hebrews 1:14 says they are ministering spirits sent to serve. They help us and work to bring forth the plan of God. So it's no wonder he tries to do that. He also targets you and I. He targets people of faith. He targets people who see Christ as their source, who walk by faith, who are in relationship with him. And we see that in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17. So when we come to 1 Timothy, Satan is attacking the faith of the church in Ephesus. And Paul challenges Timothy and us to fight for that faith, to fight for that relationship, to realize we are in a relationship and how valuable it is. In fact, you remember, Jesus said to his disciples, "You of little faith." And we talked about what little faith was, where he then says, "Hey, if you just let me be your source and you give me that inch, you just have enough faith of a mustard seed, let that be the beginning, and I'm going to grow it, and there's nothing that will be impossible for you." Your mentality is going to shift. And so this is so incredible. We have to fight for that. We have to fight the fight of faith. And Timothy's a little down, and Paul says, come on, you need to hold on to your faith. Look what some of the other people in our church have been doing. They're going towards the world. Timothy, hold on. Now, if we really want to walk by faith, if we desire to dispel darkness and stand firm in our faith, then turn on the light. Right? Turn on the light. How? By knowing the word of God and living it out in front of the world. We're unashamed of who we are. We're unashamed of the gospel. Yeah, we're in the world, but we're not of the mentality of the world. So Paul gives us some keys to remember so we can continue to walk by faith, so we can continue to keep in step with the Spirit. The first thing I want you to see is our responsibility then, our responsibility to the church of Jesus Christ. He died for the church. We have to remember that. Many times we get so narrow focus and we think the church is about a denomination. It's about the building that we are in, the location we are in. But we are the church. You and I, people, whoever accepts Jesus Christ as their Savior, that is the church. And so he loves the church with all of his heart. So much so he gave his life for the church, John 3:16. So let's look at it. Paul says this in verse 18, "This charge I entrust to you." The word there, charge, or some of your translations have instruction. It is a military term, that word. It might be better rendered, "I'm giving you this command." Okay? So, in other words, this wasn't something that needed to be discussed. This was an expectation. This was a command. This is the same word we find in 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 21, where again Paul says, "I charge you to keep these rules without prejudice." You go to 1 Timothy 6:13, again we see this same word, "I charge you," or "I command you in the presence of God who gives life to all things." So this puts Timothy's responsibility in a category of duty. Okay? I'm well aware now that word in our society really does not like to debate, does not like to discuss, does not like to talk about. We are a very indulgent culture, a very feeling-oriented society. And what we have in our culture, unfortunately, we end up having amongst us. And remember, we're the church. So if this kind of mentality is in us, if this is how we think, then it's in the church. And if it's in the church and it's being taught in the church, then that's what is in our society. And we just found out that, hey, we're in a war. There's a battle going on. I mean, the church world at large is filled with self-indulgent people and self-indulgent topics. We hear topics of success and fulfillment and freedom and spiritual satisfaction and all these self-help messages. But rarely do we ever talk about duty, especially when it comes to strengthening our faith. And I fear what has happened in the church is duty has become a dirty word. We have equated duty with legalism. We have said it's wrong to serve God out of duty. Then if we have that mentality, God wouldn't want us to have to do something. We have freedom in Christ, which is true, but in our mindset and sometimes how we have been taught, when we relate it to legalism instead of relationship, then we get so confused with what then walking by faith is all about. We say things that, well, it's wrong to come to church because we feel we have to, or because after all, I'm not bound by that. I don't have to do that. And listen, this is a very popular thinking, and it's becoming more and more so in the church at large. And my belief is it's a result of making our feelings king and compromising our convictions so that if we feel like doing it, we do it. But if we don't, we don't. If I feel like sharing my faith, I'll do it. If I don't really feel like it, it's not a big deal. Even though in Matthew 28, Jesus says, this is what I, again, command you to do. I don't know. I don't know if I really want to do that. My personality doesn't allow me to do that. So we'll come up with all kinds of things, and the result is predictable. We cultivate a Christianity or a faith, a relationship with Christ that is weak and anemic. Church, we all want deliverance, but few people desire to pay the price of discipline to achieve the freedom that God has for you and I in Christ Jesus. Now, I trust that we delight in our prayer time. I mean, I love to pray. We're getting alone with God. Oh, I love to get alone with God. I love to come on Wednesday nights as a church. But even when we don't have that feeling of excitement when it comes to prayer, when it comes to our relationship with God, it's our duty to pray. Are you following me? It's our duty. Why? Because it's part of our relationship with Christ. That's how we hone in on our source, which is Him. I mean, we may not feel like serving. We may not feel like being discipled or coming together and fellowshipping with one another. We may not feel like bearing each other's burdens or even coming to church. You say, Dale, how can you say all this? Well, I'm really just paraphrasing Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 23, where it says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day of the Lord drawing close. So it strengthens our faith when the body of Christ comes together. We grow in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And when that happens, the body of Christ grows. You say, well, I don't really need church, Dale. I'm kind of mature. I'm past that. I'm fine without it. Listen, our self-confidence betrays us if that's our mentality. I mean, more importantly, have you ever thought of this? Someone may need you. Have you ever thought that you could come into church and maybe the Lord put something on your heart and you see me and you say, Dale, hey, I'm just praying for you. I just want to encourage you. Hold tight, man. Keep going. And just maybe I need to hear that day. Maybe I was down. Maybe I was discouraged. And God has you here with the body. You're part of the body, helping another part of the body be encouraged, be strengthened. I mean, if we are going to walk by faith, we have a duty, a responsibility. And Paul wants Timothy to remember this. Paul knew duty. In Acts chapter 26 and verse 19, as he's pleading his case about his relationship with God, he says to King Agrippa, "Therefore, O king, I was not, watch this, disobedient to the heavenly vision." In Corinthians, in 2 Corinthians, as he's distraught, he says, I was pressed on every side, but not crushed. In other words, there was a duty. It was hard, but I was pressed. So many emotional things going on in my mind, but God was there for me. I was struck down, but I was not destroyed. I was persecuted, but not abandoned by God. I was perplexed. Why is this happening? But I realized, even though I didn't want to keep going, I had a duty, I had a responsibility to the call, the heavenly vision that God has given me. So I was perplexed, but you guess what? I was not in despair. How is that possible? It's possible because of faith. It's possible because faith is relationship. It's possible because Paul knew that even when he didn't feel like it, there was a responsibility. And when he pressed forward, there was growth in his relationship with Jesus Christ. Therefore, he could walk by faith. Therefore, he kept in step with the Spirit. We see in 1 Corinthians how Paul views his life. He didn't just walk by faith when he felt like it. He had a sense of compelling duty. Listen, that's a part of faith. We don't hear that. That, though, is a part of faith. We can't keep growing in relationship until we learn to discipline our feelings and bring them under a sense of duty and responsibility to his will and his desires. Look at what he says in 1 Corinthians 9:16. "For if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting, for necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am still entrusted with a stewardship." Wow. "What then is my reward? That in my preaching I may present the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel." That's amazing. I mean, Paul had a sense of divine obligation when it came to his relationship with Christ, to his ministry. Listen, that is how it is for all of us. And certainly every preacher is under that command. In 2 Timothy 4:1-2, again, "I charge you in the presence of God in Christ, who is the judge, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with complete patience." Did you catch that? Patience and teaching. Unfortunately, some people in the ministry have forgotten that truth. They don't preach the word of God. They tell a lot of stories that are really funny and very witty and clever, but really do not do much in terms of helping the body of Christ grow in relationship with Christ, discipleship, a deepening in their heart of their love for Christ and their responsibility to that salvation. What God has called us to do. Listen, whether you go to this church or somewhere else, you need to find a place that preaches the word of God, because it's the duty of the pastor to present everyone with the entire Word of God, not to give the latest pop psychology or to give them the most recent cultural analysis of what is going on, and try to blend the culture in with the Word of God so that everybody leaves happy and there's no growth. It's surface level. It doesn't dig deep into the rudiments of faith and what faith is, which is a relationship with God. It's taking up the cross and following Him. It's realizing all that God loves in the world and press towards that, and the things that God says He hates, and begin to remove yourself from that and change your mindset, because mindset matters. This is what Paul is saying. Verse 2, preach the word. Be ready. You can reprove with it. You can rebuke. You could encourage. You need to be patient in sharing the gospel and the love of Christ. You need to teach. This is not saying, Dale, can you just preach for 40 minutes and then it's all said and done and we go home and everything's nice. It's more than that. It's saying whether people like what we are saying in and out of these four walls or not, whether it's vogue to tell people about Jesus, whether it's vogue to pronounce who He is through our life or preach the Word of God, whether it's in style or out of style, we need to be aware and live a life of faith is not always going to be easy. That's what he's saying. It's not always going to be popular. People are not always going to want to hear what you and I have to say regarding the Word of God in order to build their faith to where it should be. In fact, in Ezekiel 33:30, it says, as for you, son of man, your people who walk together about you by the walls and at the doors of the houses say to one another, each to his brother, come and hear what the word is that comes from the Lord, and they come to you as people come, and they sit before you as my people, and they hear what you say, watch this, but they will not do it. They come to church, they sing the songs, they listen to the word, but you know what, and they may say, hey, good job, that was the best sermon I've ever heard. But when they go out into the world, they don't do what the word of God says. That's what this is saying. Behold, you are to them like one who sings lustful songs with a beautiful voice and plays well on an instrument, for they hear what you say, but they will not do it. Wow. I mean, that is very poetic, but very, very true. Isaiah had the same problem. In Isaiah 40, verse 21, he says, do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? You go down to verse 28. He says, have you not known again? Have you not heard? The Lord is everlasting, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He keeps telling them, are you not listening? Have you not heard? Are you not getting this? Can't you believe who God is? Exhort him, exalt him. He is forever. He loves you. He cares for you. He died for you. He wants the best for you. And Isaiah says it over and over and over. But they're not hearing. We fall into that trap as well. Church, preaching the word of God is critical. It's a critical need in the church of Jesus Christ. And as a whole, it's just not being done. And the result is we have a lot of Christians that are biblically illiterate. And therefore, anemic in their faith. What does that mean? Anemic in their walk with God. In their relationship. And so, because of that, they really don't present who Jesus Christ is outside of these four walls, because there's really no relationship with it there. They do not know what they believe and why they believe it. They do not know the basic tenets of their relationship with God, of their faith, and consequently, they then buy into every doctrine and every fad that comes along. And listen, let's take this walk by faith to heart. Everything that we have learned over these last 6 to 7 weeks, let's fight the fight of faith. Let's hold on. Let's realize that we don't have faith in faith. It's not some mystical thing that is out there that is not obtainable. It's not some hocus pocus thing and we just throw Christianity on it. We all need to get out there and fight the good fight. That's what Paul's saying. Hey, fight the good fight of faith. There's a responsibility to the church, for you and I to do that. Because God died for the church. He loves the church. We all have a function in this body. We all have a purpose. We can't allow the enemy to neutralize our lives, to keep us from growing in our faith. Church, without responding to that sense of duty, we will never effectively win. We will never effectively do what God has called us to do. We will not be effective in the battle. We will be mediocre. And we have seen in our study of Revelation that if we're neither hot nor cold, we're just out there. We're not really doing nothing. And Christ says, I would rather you be on fire, or I'd rather you just do your own thing. Because you know what? When you're mediocre, when you're lukewarm, you're giving me a bad name. Let's get over ourselves and get the gospel out. Paul reminds Timothy and us of our relationship with God, of our ministry, our duty, and to challenge us to keep walking by faith. Well, the second thing is our responsibility to God. Look at it in verse 19. Holding faith and a good conscience by rejecting this, some have made shipwreck of their relationship, of their faith. Now, throughout this letter, Paul will link faith and a good conscience together. They are a part of one another. He does this in chapter 1 in verse 5, where he says, the aim of our charge is love that issues from a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. He says in 1 Timothy 3:9, they must hold the mystery of their faith with a good conscience. So holding on to faith refers to the truth. It's committing to that truth. You believe in Christ Jesus. You have accepted him as Savior. There is a relationship there, and you strive to who he is. Paul's saying, if you want to fight the good fight of faith, we need to hold on to sound doctrine. We need to hold on to sound teaching. We need to hold on to who he is and hold tight to the word of God and build relationship with him. This is the one thing that is going to help you and I more than anything else when we come against the enemy. We learn truth, we study truth, and we apply truth. In verse 19, he says, by rejecting this, some have made shipwreck of their faith. So hold to that faith and a good conscience. Say, okay, Dale, what is a good conscience? Well, it's one that is not condemning you because you're in right relationship with Christ. We strive to have a pure conscience. Now, it's not about perfection, and we say this all the time, but it's about direction towards who Christ is. So it's one that is found by living a godly life. If we are going to live a victorious faith, it's found really in two things, and that's knowing the Word of God and living out the Word of God. What you see in the Word, what you see God tell you, that's what you do. Frankly, those two go together because throughout Scripture, there is always a link between right beliefs and right behavior. Right belief is necessary for right behavior. So let me just say this. Theological error, more often than not, has its roots in moral soil rather than intellectual soil. You say, Dale, what are you saying? Well, people teach wrong doctrine not because they lack intelligence or intellect or understanding. They teach wrong doctrine because they're evil. The reason why the theological liberals will do crazy things like vote on which of the sayings of Jesus are true, or say, you know what, well, that story really didn't happen. That's not right. Well, this is a more of a cultural thing, and And today we have evolved in our understanding of who Christ is, and what love meant back then doesn't mean that now. So as we continue to evolve in human beings, God allows that. That's what this freedom in Him is really all about. And it sounds good, but it throws us off. And the reason what happens here is they do this because there are things in their life in which they don't want to give an account. And it's easier to pare out certain parts of the Bible, and we begin to reduce it down. And if we can turn it all into a myth, then there is nothing, then nothing is accountable. We're not accountable to anything, and we do whatever we want, when we want, how we want in our life, and that's how we live our life. And that's how we equate our relationship with God. So we can still do things what we want because society says it's okay, but we have translated, we have turned away from the Word of God, and we put our stamp of approval on it. So if we have right belief, we should have right behavior. If we have right belief but not right behavior, we're not going to have a clear conscience, and we won't walk by faith. That's what he's saying. So let's choose to live a victorious life of faith. So you say, well, what's the key then to fighting the good fight? Hold to truth. Hold to truth and walk by faith. Keep in step with the Spirit. Realize how important faith is. We see it all throughout the Word of God. And then remember our responsibility then to the church. Because Christ died for the church. Again, that responsibility is to Him. Because He cares for the church so much that He gave His life. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes shall not perish, but will have life. So remember that. Remember, we have a responsibility. There's a duty there in our salvation, in our walk with God. And then remember our responsibility to the Lord. Listen, the basics of walking by faith and spiritual warfare are this. If we want to resist the devil, if we will teach the Word, learn the Word, then live out the Word of God, the enemy cannot touch us. God has a plan. God wants to do so much far above than you and I could ever think or imagine. That's why He encourages us to walk by faith. He says, hey, keep in step with the Spirit. Lean not on your own understanding. Trust in Me. And do that in all your ways. Recognize Me. And I'll light your path. I'm going to direct you. In fact, in 1 John 5:18, it says, we know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning. If you've given your life to Jesus and you know you are living, you are habitually sinning, then He's saying here, you're not of God. You're not in relationship with Him. We know that everyone who has been born of God, accepted Jesus as their Savior, does not keep on sinning. Right? There's a different mentality. Now, we all fall short of the glory of God. We all sin. I sin. You sin. But this is talking about habitually knowing we are sinning, continue to do it, regardless. That goes back to what Paul said with the conscience. Watch this. But he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch them. Wow. So when we're striving towards relationship, when we're walking by faith, there's a protection there. The enemy will not overcome you. The Bible says in temptation, in struggle, in persecution, in hardships, He'll always give us a way out. And that's why that relationship, walking by faith, is so important. We will have the righteousness of God, which will also be the breastplate for us, to protect us, Ephesians chapter 6 tells us. Listen, my prayer in this series on faith is that God will rise up an army all around the world, also in this city, in this church, people who are willing, who are ready to be obedient, people who are passionate to walk by faith. Why? Because they understand the rudiments of faith now. They understand that faith is in Christ. It is in a source, and that is Jesus. And we have to keep our eyes fixed on him. Just like with Peter, when he took his eyes off Christ on the Sea of Galilee, and Jesus picked him up and said, hey, just keep focused on me. I am your source. Don't get all caught up in your surroundings. And church, when we do that, we are going to be victorious. Amen. Well, if you're here this morning and you want to change your life around, you can't do it on your own. We need Jesus Christ. We need his salvation. He loves us so much. And if you know what, you're tired of this world, or you know in your heart, you need to give your life to him. You know, maybe we just read that if you keep on sinning, something's wrong. Where when you habitually sin and know you are, and you say, Dale, I know I'm in the wrong here, and I've turned my back on Christ. I need to get back with him. Then you just, on your screen, go to our website. We have people ready to talk, ready to pray with you, ready to guide and help and encourage you. Listen, today is the day of salvation, to give your life to him. He loves you. When we say, you know what, I'm a sinner. I've sinned against you. I want to have a relationship with you. The Bible says we become new. There's a new creation, and it's in him. He's got to help us. And maybe you need prayer, whatever it is, physical, spiritual, emotional. On the screen, you see our website there. We want to hear these requests, and we pray for them with our staff, and also on Wednesday nights in our prayer meeting. We want to pray with you as well. I hope that you have enjoyed this series. We are excited about what's coming next. You're going to see that next Sunday. You don't want to miss it. We have entitled it Shattered. And you have to come next week to see what it's all about. God bless you. We love you.